just what it feels like. Come over and dance with me. Oh, hey.
Welcome back to L.A. Jackson's Wall of Fame. We've got another great show. As usual, we try to keep the quality high around here, around these parts. Today's special guest, I can't even get into the beginnings of this guy. He's incredible. I don't know how a lot of people have missed the quality music that this young man has put out, but welcome to the first R&B artist signed to Def Jam, and everybody knows who Def Jam is. I had the wonderful pleasure of marketing and promoting his music. Welcome, Tashan. How you doing, my brother?
Hey, LA, I'm doing fine. Thank you so much, brother, for having me.
Man, it is my pleasure, man. You've always been on my mind, and when I think about the greats like Marvin Gaye and just all these old cats from the old day, Curtis Mayfield, I always make sure that you pop up in that line too, my brother, because you've been doing R&B and soul. You even cross the boundaries and go into some rock, and you've got a very, very deep history, man. I was looking on your website, and since the Sony days, I seen, man, you've got a total of like 12 albums, man, and you're the best artist that a lot of people just haven't heard about, man. Tell us about yourself, brother. How'd you get started in the business?
Thanks, Billy. I appreciate that, man. I got started professionally, you know, as a background singer with the Fat Boys. I worked with Curtis Blow, and Curtis Blow had me sing on the Fat Boys' debut album.
Nice.
Can You Feel It? And stuff like that. You know, that's how I really got, wanted to make a name for myself as a singer, coming from Poughkeepsie, New York, down to the city. And then, you know, from working with Curtis and the Fat Boys, I got introduced to Russell Simmons. You know, this was in the early stages before Def Jam was even formed.
Wow.
And, you know, so as a background singer, I went from there, and then the meetings that I would have, you know, back in those days down on Elizabeth Street, I ran into Jahlil and Ecstasy from Houdini in Russell's office, and they were just about to go over to London, England to, you know, record their debut album,
mm-hmm.
which was on Jive. And then,
oh, I was just going to ask why so far away, but Jive is
because their label was based out of the UK,
right?
You know, because Houdini was, you know, groundbreaking for that, because it really wasn't that many. That actually probably were one of the first rap acts that whose label was based out of London.
Right.
So I was playing a demo in the office at the time, like just me, demo that I made, just me playing the piano. It had songs like Got the Right Attitude on it and Love Is, and Jahlil really liked my voice. He liked the style of R&B, what I was doing. And then he asked me, you know, man, hey, I'm getting ready to go make this debut album. Would you like to come, you know, with us over to record a song? So me being, you know, young and wanting to get into the business, into the industry, I was like really happy to do that. We ended up writing and producing the song Yours for a Night, which was on their debut album.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's basically how I pretty much got started, bought into the game through Jahlil and Ecstasy from Houdini.
Amazing, man.
And then, you know, from that, Afrika Bambaataa, well, I'm sure a lot of people, you know who Afrika Bambaataa is, world famous DJ. He heard the for a Night record. And he liked my voice on that record. He liked the style. So then I joined his spinoff group he had called Shango. And then from there, I got a chance to, you know, travel the world. I already left the country to go to London, but
right.
With Bambaataa, I got to go to Japan, and so I got exposed to the world and got a chance to really get my feet wet and see what it was like, you know, traveling as a working musician. And so that's my humble beginnings right there. And then obviously from there, when I came back off tour with Bambaataa, I started writing my own songs, and then eventually still had my relationship with Russell, and then got signed to Def Jam and made the Chasing a Dream record in 1985.
That's amazing, because another reason why I have such a deep connection with you is both of our careers started roughly around the same time, because I started interning with CBS Records in 84, and that was right when the Def Jam deal got sealed with Columbia Records, and then by 85, 86, I was in the full swing of things over there, and Def Jam started putting out all of these releases, and you always stood out, because I remember when the promos would come in, you know, obviously be all the hip-hop, but then all of a sudden, I got this R&B singer on Def Jam, and I was, like, most amazed. I was like, what? They're really expanding, and I was just glad it was you. And since then, what did they do? They came out with Allison Williams, Chuck Stanley, Orange Juice Jones, but you were the trendsetter, man. I mean, and Chasing a Dream is no joke, man, and you always have been putting out a lot of songs that really stirred social consciousness, and you know, again, you have to be a deep artist and thinking about a lot of stuff to make a social statement. So I can tell that that's inbred within you to be socially aware just from the music you put out.
Oh, definitely, definitely. Like, you know, that comes from me being influenced by Curtis Mayfield, you know, and Marvin Gaye, you know, and then at that time, like, also at that time, well, from 85 leading into the Chasing a Dream, and had a record on also on that album called Thank You Father, which is like a contemporary gospel record, and that kind of led into the second album, you know, where I was able to record do videos for Black Man and Save the Family. So that the whole conscious movement at that time, you know, was with Public Enemy, and then to bring socially relevant like lyrics and songs back into R&B music, because for a while that had been missing. But obviously, you know, that's a big part of Black music, you know, that the artists, you know, would sing about or write about things that were going on, you know, in the community, and just issues that people needed to hear about and wanted to talk about and hear on records, other than just about love and romance, you know. So Save the Family and Black Man were those two records that really exemplified that I wanted to blend socially conscious music as well with, you know, with more traditional R&B on my records.
That's cool. So with you being on the socially conscious tip, did that enable you, or was that a springboard that you were able to use to work with other Def Jam artists, or did you clearly separate yourself from the whole hip-hop movement as far as, you know, what Def Jam was releasing all the time?
Well, it kind of just made it seem, because at the time, like, that On the Horizon record was on an imprint. It was Original Black Records, OBR.
Right, OBR.
Yeah, so it was like it was an imprint label. But what it was is during that time, we went on a Def Jam Soul Songs tour. It was myself, Allison Williams, Chuck Stanley, Orange Juice Jones. Orange obviously had the big hit record at that time.
The Rain.
What we got to do is that all four of us got it. You know, we had one band that played for everybody. We had a tight show. We got a chance to, you know, to travel to England, France, you know, different parts of Europe. And then just the experience, it was kind of like a throwback to like the Motown Review, you know, mm-hmm. kind of vibe, where we'll, you know, when a person would see the F Jam label, when they would see that, they would think that it was primarily rap. At the time, like, Russell also had a vision that he wanted to do R&B as well. So, being the socially conscious kind of stuff that I was doing, and that was cool because it was still able to just expand it a little bit more, like, so people could think that, wow, Def Jam does have R&B and soul on it as well.
That's right.
So it was really good. It was a really good opportunity for me to just, and I had the freedom, you know, to just basically write what I wanted to write.
That's great. So cool, man. So with you doing R&B, did the compositional process begin with, say, a drum machine like a lot of people, or did you start with a musical instrument, with a piano or guitar or something?
Well, most of my songs, I write from the piano. the majority of them, like, I would, you know, sit and play, start with the bass line, the chords, and then, you know, come up with, like, from, you know, the melody. I would create the melody from there. But also, I got a chance to work with a great producer named Sam Sever. That was on the second record. So he was a hip-hop producer.
Oh, wow.
Who made, you know... So my whole thing with even from Chasing the Dream and On the Horizon was that I wanted to blend hip-hop, because I love rap music. I love hip-hop beats. I wanted to blend, you know, soul R&B melodies on top of the hip-hop rhythm, you know what I'm saying? Which mm-hmm. is obviously what they have today, like, you know, hip-hop soul, but that's to blend those two together was really what I was after. So that's kind of like the formula that created both those records.
That's incredible. Now, as an artist, I mean, you started off just off the rip, just going on out from the Houdini days and traveling around. Did that make a big impact on you so early in your career, as opposed to having a couple records out and then finally getting to go out and tour the world? Did that kind of change your perspectives early on in your career?
Oh, man, that was incredible. I mean, you got to figure, you know, I was 21 years old, and the first chance I get to make a record, I have to get on a plane, get my first time getting a passport, and record all the way in London, England. So there's really, you know, there's no really way for me to really express to you how that really just opened up my mind to not only different cultures, but to be able to just, the first time out, to be able to travel and at the same time be able to do something that I love so much and wanted to make a name for myself and start my career. So it was incredible.
That's cool, man. So, I mean, I was looking at the bio, man, and on your website at www.tashan7.com, you have such a discography, and just traveling around, and, you know, I have to call you a world-class man of international mystery, because, man, you've gone to so many places that I only could dream of going to. So let me just ask you, just as a fan, going to places like Brazil, Italy, Japan, Germany, France, Sweden, just all over, in your perspective, does the world look like it's all the same, or just tallying up your experiences at all these different countries, are they all uniquely different in their own way, or does it look like, you know, hey, the world is really just one big bubble? What's your opinion?
Well, I mean, culturally, like, each one of those places is definitely different in its own way, you know, just because of the people and, you know, their customs and the scenery. Like, for instance, like, well, for me, Brazil is just a beautiful, beautiful country, but you also look at the dichotomy between the difference of, you know, some parts of Brazil where there's poverty, and there's other parts of Brazil where there's the beaches and, you know, just a whole bunch of just rich people. So, but I mean, at the same time, you know, my other experiences of going to Japan and those other countries that you named, the one thing I found that's universal is that people love soul music, you know, R&B
mm-hmm.
and soul music. It's kind of like, it's the common denominator that I found in all of the places that I traveled to. And that I was able to, you know, to find that there was a fan base there. There was a people that enjoyed the music. They definitely remembered, you know, early Motown music and the tradition of what R&B and soul is. And then I feel like when I was blessed to have the opportunity to, you know, perform and make those records and perform in those countries, I just wanted to carry on the tradition of the kind of music that I was raised up on and the kind of music that I loved. So, you know, if you look from a global perspective, you know, people are pretty much the same when it comes to how you feel and how they react emotionally, you know, to certain kinds of music. And definitely R&B and soul is a universal language, I feel, all over the world.
Cool, man. Well, I got one more country I want to ask you about, but first we're going to break away and go to the groundbreaking record that puts you on the map, at least within the CBS Records family, as far as I was working. Let's check out Chasing a Dream. That was such a, I really liked that song. Tell us about how that one came about.
Wow, Chasing a Dream. I kind of like, that's kind of like my mantra, you know what I'm saying? That's the original vibe that I was set off on when I was a sophomore at Howard University. I first wrote that, those lyrics coming back from campus back to my dorm, and it's just that when that hook first came to me, chasing a dream, you got me chasing a dream.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that pretty much set the tone for that record, and even right now, you know, it still means a lot to me right now, because the whole concept was that we took a sample of Dr. Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. So at the beginning of the record, you hear that, and the whole premise of that record is that whatever dream it is that you have, you know, in life, or things that you want to accomplish, you know, you're going to have to chase after it in order to catch it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're gonna have to put in the work. You're gonna have to, you know, work. Make sure you focus on what it is you're trying to do. Come up with a plan. Execute the plan. And basically, you know, at the same time while you're going through your struggles, ups and downs, learning, you know, trying to achieve what it is you're trying to get, you got to chase after in order to catch it. So that's pretty much how I was feeling. And then I implemented the rock and roll. Rock guitar into the record at the same time, so it was kind of like a tribute to my love for you know, Jimi Hendrix, rock and roll music.
Mm-hmm.
I had the rock blended in with the hip hop and blended in with the soul. So everything about Chasing the Dream pretty much identifies who I was at the time as the artist Tashan.
Cool, man. Another thing that's very significant to me about that song is its title, Chasing the Dream, and then it's a connection with Martin Luther King as far as I Have a Dream. So, Chasing the Dream, I Have a Dream. So, I could never, it's very, very significant to me personally, and I just could never separate the two of them. I always think of the two of them together. But anyway, let's check out Chasing a Dream.
Check. Chasing a dream, got me chasing a dream. Chasing a dream, got me chasing a dream. Chasing a dream, got me chasing a dream. Which way to go? Happiness is my goal. I have no idea how I'm gonna make it, 'cause this world is oh so cold. I can't find a job, I don't wanna rob. So what am I supposed to do?
That is such a great song, man. Chasing a dream. Got me. Chasing a dream. Makes me just want to stand up and march, man. It's like, you know, because I still have that same dream myself. Is I'm still chasing my dream. I mean, I take that song very personally because, you know, I feel a connection to it, you know?
That's it. I mean, I'm thankful that we're still, you know, even this energy, just talking to you right now is a testament to that, man. You know, considering that has been over 25-something years, you know.
Mm-hmm, and it's still relevant.
And I just want to, I just want to say, you know, thank you for the opportunity to talk, you know, with you and to be heard by your listeners. And hopefully, you know, the song itself, you know, Chasing the Dream, hopefully that song will resonate with people when they get a chance to really listen to the lyrics and apply it to their life. So, thank you, sir.
And you know, there's another thing, and I always said that you're one of the, you still hadn't had your big break yet, you know. It's just like a certain, there's a couple of musicians, singers, and stuff like that, and even actors that I've been watching for a while, and like Blair Underwood, and a couple other cats out there, but I still think that that big blockbuster project hasn't come out yet. And I'm patiently waiting for that to happen, you know, because you're one of music's best kept secrets. I mean, and you're well nurtured. You know, you've got a great background. You come from a good solid family lifestyle. You've certainly got a track record with all these records. And folks, I urge you, please get out and check this guy out. Go to Tashan7.com. Look at the incredible amount of music releases he has. But jumping back to the different countries, and with me being as far as my background being Jamaican, you know, I'm just compelled to ask you whether you've you know, jumped into or experimented with any kind of reggae, whether you've ever been to Jamaica. Do you have any kind of Jamaican audience at all?
Well, I've never had the pleasure of going to Jamaica.
Well, you need to, man. You need to make that a very big point in your life, man.
Yes, man. That would be one place I would really love to go. But I mean, I do know that there's a very, very heavy Jamaican influence in London, England. you know, because when I lived over in England for a while and I recorded a lot of songs over there, more specifically the For the Sake of Love album, you know, there's a very, very large Jamaican community there.
You know, that's funny that you said that, because I was just watching a movie last week, and I'd never even heard of this movie, but it was filmed in London, and it focused totally on that Jamaican community in London, and it had Eric LaSalle playing a Jamaican drug dealer, man, and he did a fantastic job. I was very, very impressed, but it was all about, I guess, like the drug underculture with the Jamaicans and Irish and the Londoners, and I was very, very surprised to see just from the scenery, how it looked like a combination of the hoods of New York and Jamaica kind of combined.
Right. Well, I do have a reggae influenced record that I'm going to send to you.
Oh, cool.
It's called If a Kiss. If a Kiss. It's on the Grumpy Quiet album.
Okay.
From the website.
Nice,
and
nice.
It has a reggae rhythm, reggae backing track.
Yeah, I want to check that out, man. And like I said, you've got so many tracks. I mean, you sent me a couple yesterday. I've got my couple that I always liked, and we'll probably get to four of them today. But please, if you could come back again, I would love to have you. You're my brother. We've got 20 years of knowing each other, so I definitely would welcome you coming back so we could talk more and play some more tracks, including that one.
I'd be honored, man. Thank you so much, L.A., really.
Man, and while, you know, we were talking the other day, man, and, you know, jumping off in another direction, man, I want to get your feedback on that book that you mentioned to me, How to Get Out of Your Own Way. I mean, you told me it was so influential to you. Now tell the audience about it.
Oh, man, definitely. It's a book written by the singer, actor, Tyrese Gibson. Yeah? And it's the New York Times bestseller, How to Get Out of Your Own Way. And it's just a book, you know, it's a very interesting book. You know, my girlfriend turned me onto this book, and I've just keep going back and forth to it. Because, I mean, he gives a detailed description of how he's, you know, coming up out of L.A., where he was from. He just gives a, you know, detailed description of how it is, his struggle, you know, what it is you want to do, trying to accomplish, you know, your dreams and things you want to do in life. And the basic premise of what he's saying is that sometimes you have to get out of your own way. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You have to, like, try to remain positive, you know, get out of your own way so that whatever God's will is for your life, that you're able to be in a position where you can accept and fulfill that role and go on and be the best possible person you can be. You know what I'm saying? And it has, like, even on the front of the book, I mean, it just says, like, there's a quote from Will Smith, and I just want to share it with you. It says, in the recent years, I've witnessed Tyrese Gibson learn how to get out of his own way as he wrestled his destiny from the fickle hands of fate, you know, and that's a quote from Will Smith. So the whole part about wrestling your destiny from the fickle hands of fate, I mean, it's a powerful statement. It's a powerful book. And I think that a lot of aspiring singers or, you know, actors or just people in general can really read the book and get a lot from it. You know, I did. I definitely did.
That's great, so, man. That's great. Now, you know about my book, Musicology 2101, A Quick Start Guide to Music Biz History. And I've got a big book signing party this Saturday over at Club Blitz in Riverdale. And I want to thank my buddies Rodney and Mike for having me over there. But, you know, my book one ended up being so thick that I ended up splitting that one into three books, and so now I've got a total of six books in the Musicology series, and I bring all that up to say that I was so inspired by you, my brother, that, you know, I had to do a profile on you in one of them, and it was originally in book one, but because I had to split it in three, yours ended up being in towards the end, which is the third book. So I'm hoping that the time goes by fast so I can hurry up and get this first book out there, propagated out in the world, actually, and then drop the second book early 2014, and hopefully by the summer of 2014 I can get that third book out, because I'm really anxious for people to know your story. You know, there are a lot of people that just hadn't had the spotlight fully shining on them, and I'm hoping that Musicology will be one tool, and I don't want to wait that long for, you know, your light to get turned on full blast, but I certainly want to put in my two cents and shine my perspective and my light on you, man. So I just can't wait till that book comes out. And I, you know, it's so good, man. I did a lot of research. I combined that research with just what I know about you, dealing with you all through our periods after Sony. You know, we've kept in touch with each other. I remember, you know, you going back and forth from Poughkeepsie back to the city, and you know, it's just great knowing someone like you, someone that's so, you know, focused on accomplishing a mission. And I said all of that to say that, dude, I think you got a book in you too, man. I would love to see a book that tells your story, man.
I really appreciate you, bro, for that. You know, I've been keeping a journal since 1986, so I think that there's somewhere there might be a book somewhere in there. I would probably definitely title the book "Chasing a Dream," because that's pretty much where it is. You know,
absolutely. Because the other thing is, a book like that tells your story actually could develop into a movie. And I love movies about musicians and artists, man, and record labels. I from Cadillac Records on down to the, you know, Motown story. I just always learn something. I always feel some kind of connection, and especially if the actors are good, you know, it's just going to be a wonderful movie. And the way it would end, obviously, would be with your experimentation and evolution, expanding past the R&B and soul that you've done. And we're definitely going to talk in depth about your Tommy Rock and your whole rock experience, because I'm looking at the picture now of the album cover, and it looks so Jimi Hendrix, man. It's amazing.
Yeah, that's it. It's Jimi Hendrix has always been a big influence, man. I just felt like, you know, there's a whole lot of freedom in the kind of stuff that, you know, that he's done in recording.
Cool.
And
hang on one second. We're going to pick up. You know, we were picking up. We were talking about the, exposure and the Musicology. I might have even forgotten to mention the exposure CD that goes along with Musicology, but I certainly want to mention it now. And you know, every book has an exposure CD, which, you know, is an accompanying CD featuring music by artists I'm working with. So I certainly would welcome having you on the next exposure CD for Musicology 2102. And
putting a lot of work, bro.
Yeah, man, I'm trying to, man. I mean, this is it. I mean, you said it yourself, man. You know, this is our life statement. If we don't make one, you know, we could end up, you know, dying with it tucked away inside of us. So I want to show people the depth of, you know, the music artists that I'm working with that I highly respect, and you're definitely one of them. So I can't, you know, not put out an exposure without a contribution by Tashan.
I appreciate that. You know, what else I was thinking too, LA? Is,
yeah,
that when you mentioned about the reggae influence record, you might be able to throw that into the interview too, because I think that might be a little bit more crucial.
For
that
sure.
That might be a good idea. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'll send that to you, you know, when we finish on the phone.
Absolutely, man. And we'll get that
there. I think you like that a lot.
Oh, for sure, man. Anything. I mean, I like all kinds of music anyway, but every time I notice that I'm listening to music, I'll go all the way around the dial. I'll do my R&B thing. I'll do my funk thing. I'll do my disco thing. I'll do my rock thing. I'll do my jazz thing. But I always come back and settle down on home base, which is reggae. And, you know, it's not my fault, man. I grew up, the first music I was listening to was calypso music when I was a kid. So calypso evolved into the reggae, so that's always been, you know, my home base. Always. So, yeah, I welcome that that track from you, and I'm going to go back on the website again and check it out and listen to it online. But I want to talk about your artwork, man. You've got such distinctive visuals, man. Do you get an artist to come up with these ideas, or do they begin in your head and then get visualized and turned into something visually stimulating? Because, like I said, man, every one of your albums really, really have a definitive look.
Well, the pictures from the first couple albums, I worked with a photographer named Jeffrey Stills.
Okay.
You know, and the Chasing the Dream album, On the Horizon, and then the Life Goes On album, which was my first independent release. That was from a live performance I did in Italy. So I used that as the cover. And then the last few album covers, which is basically homemade, you know, took a photograph. The Tommy Rock picture for itself, for instance, is a photograph, and then just kind of like photoshopped it and gave it that kind of 70s kind of posterized look, you know.
That is so cool. I noticed, because I'm a mustache man, you know, and I don't think I'm going to trim mine off, but I like the look when you the change of look, like on a Pouring Like Rain. You shaved the mustache off and got the sunglasses on, and it's a big jump over, man. I think that it's very, very interesting that you have the courage to, you know, shave off and pursue a different look.
That's my Superman look. Superman look.
And then with Tommy Rock, it looks like you've got an afro, and you've got that the Jimi Hendrix style mustache that's coming all the way down. And you know, just amazing, man.
I'm still acting, still trying to act like I'm a singer, you know.
Well, because of that Tommy Rock, let me ask you. I mean, since you're musically inclined, anyway, do you go as far as picking up a guitar and actually playing guitar like Jimmy and everything?
Nah. Well, you know, honest with you, LA, I tried to play it a couple times, and that's an instrument that should not be played with unless you're really gonna study and master it. So I pretty much left the guitar playing to Jerome Scorpio Child Dickens, who plays in my band. He's actually played with me since the Def Jam Soul Songs tour. He played on all of the albums that I recorded. So I leave the guitar
player.
I'm the front man. I'm the front man of the rock band, Tommy Rock.
I got you, man. I'm still kicking myself, because when I was about 10, my parents sent me and my brother off to he was taking piano lessons and I was taking guitar lessons, and that was just before my rebellion era. So I obviously went into my rebellion mode and just stopped taking, you know, music lessons. And if I just stuck with that guitar lesson, I tell you what, I could have been so good, because I've always been like in my adult life, I've been a closet keyboard player. Wasn't all that great. Then I found out I was a better engineer than a keyboard player, so I jumped into that. And then I found out that I could also do the executive and with working at a record label. So that was kind of where I bounced between engineering and the administrative end. But I tell you what, I'm going to, one of these days when I'm able to stop chasing the dollar, I'm going to sit down and go back, and I don't care how old I am, I'm definitely going to take me some music lessons, keyboard, bass, and drums.
You going to do it all?
Yeah, why not? Why
yeah,
not?
Man, that's it. Like I have a great respect for guitar players.
Me too.
Musician wise and off drummers.
Yep.
You know, I play a little bit of keyboards myself. Uh-huh. You know, I love to write songs. But any musician that really is dedicated to his instrument, and mine primarily is my voice, you know, is definitely to be respected. You know, when you put in the time and the energy you know, to perfect your craft and just, you know, to express your feelings and your emotions through your instrument.
Absolutely. Absolutely, man. I tell you what, that's so cool. And, you know, it's chasing a dream. It takes you to the sky. It takes you to the cloud. And just saying cloud makes me think of your next song, Sitting on a Cloud. So set that up. Tell us about that one.
Well, Sitting on a Cloud is, I did that record with Spliffman, and then, which was definitely the artist that you introduced me to. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah, he's a great guy, man. I met him.
Yeah,
I met him through Reverb Nation. I'm still working with him. Matter of fact, I got one of his songs on the Exposure 3 release called VVIP Ballin', and it's a great song. And I'm going to make sure you get that. Oh, well, you already have it. But I'm going to make sure you get the Exposure CD, though, man. It's just got great stuff on it. But, yeah, back to Sitting on a Cloud with Joe Black, a.k.a. Spliffer Man.
That's right. Joe Black, that's my man. Like, when we first linked, I know that I was listening to a lot of his records. And, you know, if you listen to his style of rap, you know, and the way he expresses himself through hip-hop, his lyrics to me in that particular record are very poignant, you know what I'm saying? Because what I'm talking about in the hook is like the perspective of sitting on the cloud watching the world go round. It's a universal record, like just hoping and praying for universal peace, you know, amongst people. And then the way he breaks it down, you know, it's blending, you know, R&B soul chorus, you know, with a rap verse. So the original Sitting on the Cloud is from the Pouring Like Rain album. And, you know, when you listen to that, I talk about just like that there were two friends. They were really, really, really close. And then one happened, you know, one shot the other one.
Oh, wow.
And then, you know, it talks about how the two families who, you know, each family was affected, how one brother lost his life, and then the other brother went to prison for life. And it just talks about drugs, talks about how drugs have impacted and hurt the community, and it talks about how people, you know, who are affected the most, which are the children.
Yeah.
So the theme of the record is save the children. It's a song that just really tries to look at how do we heal ourselves, you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, man. Okay.
You know, we know about the issues that's going on, but how do we just look within ourselves as a community and as a people? How do we address those issues?
Okay.
And how do we come about it to make you know, things better for ourselves?
Okay. Well, without further ado, here's Sitting on a Cloud.
What does it profit a man to gain the world over diamonds and golds and lose his soul? Hey, Tashan, you ready, man? Joe Black, a.k.a. Spliffer, man. South City boy. I got this on the reggae tip right now, right? Remix!
Sitting on the cloud.
It's what we do.
Watching the world go round.
I'm so amazed.
Thing I can say,
what is that?
Why can't we just come together
and keep love moving along? You know, together we
learn
can be strong.
Love one another
and keep love moving along. You know, together we could be strong.
Sitting on the cloud
is what we do.
Watching the world go round.
I'm so amazed.
Only thing I can say,
why is that?
Why can't we just come together?
And keep love moving along. You know, together we
learn
can be strong.
Love one another.
And keep love moving along.
Roots,
you know, together we can be strong. I woke up, tree birds singing by my window. Hail each. Well, I'm rolling up my endo. It's a good day, I got to share it with my friends. Must break bread no matter how little it ends. But they got the ghetto in a lockdown. 357's automatics, it's a showdown. Walking through the trenches in my Gideon boots. Never will I falter, Jah it be the truth. Youths!
Sitting on the cloud.
It's what we do.
Watching the world go round.
I'm so amazed.
Only thing I can say.
What is that?
Why can't we just come together?
I
and keep love moving along. You know, together we can be strong.
Love one another.
And keep love moving along. You know, together we can be strong. Bring it back.
Sitting on the cloud.
It's what we do.
Watching the world go round.
I'm in a haze.
Only thing I can say.
Why is that?
Why can't we just come together?
And keep love moving along. You know, together we
learn
can be
to
strong.
Love one another.
And keep love moving along. You know, together we can be strong. Injustice and iniquity wrapped up in pretty schemes. They tossing and we turning, cause the world of evil dreams. They tried to seal it. Future generation turning fiends. Corporate corruption, indoctrination, laws of triple beam. Seen, I'm asking, where has the love gone? When you're feeling pain, you know you got to stay strong. To the masses, never give up in your face. And in love and not hate is never late. Real!
Sitting on the cloud.
It's what we do.
Watching the world go round.
I'm so amazed.
Only thing I can say.
Why is that?
Why can't we just come together?
And keep love moving along. You know together we can be strong.
Love one another.
And keep love moving along. You know together we can be strong. Bring it back.
Sitting on the cloud.
It's what we do.
Watching the world go round.
I'm in a haze.
Only thing I can say.
What is that?
Why can't we just come together?
And keep love moving along. You know together we
learn
can be strong.
Love one another.
And keep love moving along. You know together we can be strong.
Sitting on the cloud.
It's what we do.
Watching the world go round.
I'm in a maze.
Only thing I can say.
Why is that?
Why can't we just come together?
And keep love moving along. You know together we
learn
can be strong.
Love one another.
And keep love moving along. You know together we can be strong. Bring it back.
Sitting on the cloud.
Yo, Tashan.
Watching the world go round.
What we do, man?
Only thing I can say.
Yeah, so respect, sir.
Why can't we just come together?
To the dead ATL, to the dead to USA.
Learn to love one another.
You gotta bring back the love, man. In every way. Peace out. One love.
Yeah, yeah, that certainly brings back memories. I remember I was so excited hooking you guys up and, you know, how fast y'all worked to put that together. I mean, within just, you know, days of the introduction, y'all were already doing it. And the final result was just really, really, really good. And I just got to, you know, applaud you and tip my hat to both you and Joe Black on your mission to make this project. And even though he was in Trinidad and you were in New York, you know, through technology, and that's the next topic we're going to jump on is technology, but through technology you guys have been able to put this project together, and now it's sitting out there in the universe, man. And so how has technology impacted the way that you do things as far as making tracks and your music and everything?
Well, I think that the greatest impact it has made is that it's become a lot easier to work with different producers, even though you're not in the same, you might not even be in the same city. You don't even really have to be in the same studio. The way, you know, the producer can put together a track and then send you the music, you know, just email you the MP3, and I'm able to sit there, write the lyrics, you know, to the song from there, and then transpose all of that into Pro Tools, record the vocals right over the music.
Are you good with Pro Tools?
No, I don't touch any buttons, y'all. I leave that strictly to the. Like I said, I got a great respect for engineers as well. You know, the many talented ones that I work with, but I try. It just takes so much. Like some artists and producers are able to do both. I like to just focus and stay in my lane, because that's a whole, you know, that's a art form in itself. You know?
Yes, it is, without a doubt.
And it's definitely to be respected, because I mean, it takes a combination of a lot of different things. You know, being able to come up with the lyrics and the melody, and then to work with. Work with the producer of the music, and then technology makes it so so much easier to track and create a record, you know. And it's with the way the digital age, so the sound, there's no sound quality loss. And I think the turnover, you're able to make the turnover on how fast and how quickly you can come up with an idea and have it recorded, you know, is pretty much evident in the way me and Joe Black put together the Sitting on the Cloud record.
Yeah, that's just incredible, man. I tell you what, and we're both probably around, we are both around the same age, and we both seen the transition. I remember when I was little, the 8-tracks were kind of going on the way out, and the cassettes were just coming in, but the vinyl was always there. But what wasn't there was the 12-inches, so I saw the transition from the 7-inch and the 12-inch album to disco singles, and then, of course, the remixes and extended remixes. And I talk about this all the time, and I guess I'm a nostalgic kind of guy, but, you know, I kind of miss those 12 inches and the albums and the artwork and touching the albums, touching the cassettes. Even I used to pull the cassettes out, man. I kid you not. I used to, when the tapes got raveled up on the cassette, I would pull them out and I'd cut off the part that was all wrinkled up and retape it, and still got usage out of my tape, man. And I even opened up cassettes and pulled them out and did stuff with them, and just incredible amount of different things. And now, of course, you know, you got the MP3s, you can't touch it, and I kind of miss that.
That's it. I was pretty much thinking the same thing. I spend a lot of time just reading all the liner notes on the back of the album covers. You know, mm-hmm. That's how I grew up, and that was a big part of listening to the music and getting the whole experience. You know, the album cover and the whole thing. But that's one of the things about technology right now today is like you really can't touch music. You know, it's either it's on a phone, or it's on a MP3 player, or it's coming directly off the computer. You know.
Yeah. So where do you think it's all going? Where do you think it's all going?
Ooh, I don't know.
What's next?
Who knows? I really, to be honest with you, man, it's like, because I'm thinking like now, like you think about the sound quality of what you can get, you know, just from the MP3 and streaming music.
I mean, yeah.
I'm still amazed at that alone, you know, and it makes it so much easier for people to access the music. You know?
Yeah.
We obviously know that, you know, pretty much gone are the days of a person going to, you know, get in their car or going to the mall or going to a record store and physically buying a record.
Yeah.
Most of this music is transferred, over the computer. And
yeah.
It's sharing files of music that way.
And every copy is master quality.
Yes. Yes, sir. I mean, the accessibility to it and the sound quality and the ability to just, you know, get it instant is worth it.
Oh, yeah. Definitely, man. So, and another thing, too, with the elimination of the physical product, I think it opens up a lot of possibilities to do what you and Joe Black did, which was remixing. You have the ability to change the lyrics, change the vocals, edit them out and put new stuff in. You can, you know, put in new musical ideas and just come up with tons of different versions much easier, you know, for each song.
Truly, technology, it gives you more flexibility when it comes to making records, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I've experienced. But and like I said before, but the engineering side of it, I always work with, you know, engineers that are proficient in Pro Tools, using that program, and it just gives me the freedom to just worry about the vocal performance, just worry about, you know, bringing the song across.
For sure.
I think it's a good combination when everybody's on top of their job.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's
to
right.
Come up with the best finished product. Yeah.
That's it. That's the whole trifecta right there, is having the whole team. And then, of course, and see, with you guys being on the creative side, making it, you know, and I've been blessed, man, because I've been able to jump from, you know, one side to the other, so I participate in the creative side with making the song. But also, once it's done, that's kind of when a lot of my work begins, because I go back in and I, you know, got to make sure bios are together, one sheets are together, marketing plans are together. There's merchandising with posters and, you know, stuff like that, getting the physical materials and tools you need to promote it out in the street in the real world. So I have to deal with that end, especially with the artists I'm working with through my own MKM Entertainment. And shout out to my boy Wade Jones, my partner with Pete City Records, and you know, the other artists that I'm working with too. And you know, it's a whole process, and you've got to have people that are good at, you know, fulfilling their part.
And I've always, from our relationship and friendship over the years, you know, that's one thing I always respected about you, was, you know, the times that, from knowing you at Sony, you know, you were always a type of person that really took pride in what you were doing, but you had a relationship with the artist as well. You know?
Absolutely.
And I think that, you know, that's very important for me in my career and my association with you. You've always, you know, shown a real concern for the artist. You know,
that's right, and I always will.
Yeah, well, cause sometimes, you know, you figure like an artist puts a lot of time and energy into making a record or putting together a project, but then that music is that music and that product is still dependent upon, you know, the people who take the music and market it to the masses so that it can get heard.
That's right.
You know, and that's a very integral part.
That's right.
Developing an artist.
That's right.
It's very important that you have people dedicated to do that.
So for sure, for sure.
I appreciate you for that, brother, and the fact that you're still doing it for the artists that you work with.
Well, I want to work much more closely with you to help you get where you've got to go, man. I mean, from just looking at all the stuff that you've got, man, I've got a couple ideas that I'm going to pitch to you later on, and, you know, it's going to just, again, I see that you have a... The Best of Tashan. I want to take that idea or that concept and take it to a whole nother level, with maybe a double album kind of deal, man, or a video album or something like that. But we'll get into that later on. But right now, let's go on and check out another track called Right Now. Go on and set that up, bro.
Oh, man. Right Now is from the All or Nothing album at Tashan7.com, TASHAN7.com. This song here is, you know, will remind you automatically of, you know, singers like Bobby Womack, you know, that kind of style with the wah-wah guitar and the bass line. And it's just an old-school slow jam. That's it.
Let's check it out right now.
Of a fully clothed girl, you're my lucky charm. Shower you with hugs and kisses all over. Walk down the aisle of life arm in arm. All of our prayers have been answered. This is what we both dreamed of. Nothing but joy and happiness, truly sent from above. To me, loving in the moment, right now is all that matters to me. Loving in the moment, what ain't meant for me just wasn't meant for me. Had to lose all the emotions to finally see what a blessing it is. Look into your face. Her leaving gave a woman more worthy opportunity to take her place. But right now is all that matters to me. Destiny. Right now
to me.
How
does it feel?
Does it feel
to be in love with somebody?
As experience
shows
the way.
You know the deal. When you have nobody,
nobody,
say goodbye,
goodbye, goodbye
to all the lonely days. You know the past is
gone.
Tomorrow's not promised. Just live in the moment, baby, right now is all that matters to me. You are my world, my destiny. Oh, right now
is all that matters to me.
Tashan, and to all the radio stations out there, especially with the proliferation of the millions of internet radio stations out there, y'all owe it to yourself to install some Tashan music into your playlist. He's got so much, you know, he's got R&B, he's got soul, he's got different styles within them. You know, he's just a deep brother, and this is my personal message to even the terrestrial radio stations, too. Y'all ain't doing enough on this end, and y'all need to step up your game.
Thanks for that, bro. We even got the Tashan 7 house.
What?
For the house music.
Like dance
too,
and everything? Get out of here, man. Now, are you pulling a Colonel Abrams on us?
Well, Colonel Abrams, I don't know. It reminds me of L.A. To me, house music to me is like gospel in a way.
Okay.
Because of the rhythm, and then the lyrics on the songs. I mean, obviously, you know, with the type of songs that are on Tashan 7 House, that particular album, I have a song called "Lift Your Soul."
Okay.
And then I have a song called "Soul Survivors."
I like that title.
Gray Skies Turn Blue. So the combination of the up-tempo house rhythm, you know what I'm saying, with the lyrics, and it gives me the feeling of gospel music blending in with dance music.
Amazing.
So soulful house, that's what it is.
Oh, wow. Okay. Nice, man. Well, I'll tell you what. What's ahead for you, bro? What's going on? The next move for Tashan, I know we were talking about trying to get you down here in Atlanta doing a couple shows. And the funny thing about this market is you could actually do each one of those genres of music that you do all under the same roof in certain places, certain parts of town. And if not, you can go within 15, 20 minutes of each venue and do each genre of music that you perform, man.
That's definitely something that I would be interested in doing. You know, I think for my stage of where I'm at right now in my career, it's about, you know, performing live,
mm-hmm.
and working with a band and just bringing the music directly to the people. You know,
yeah.
The whole aspect of doing live performances and shows, I think that'll never go away, because people are going to always want to go out. They're going to always want to hear, get that experience of seeing a person live singing, you know. And for me to be able to do R&B and soul on one end, and then to also go and do, you know, a rock and roll set, you know, with the band Tommy Rock. So that's the next phase of where I'm at with my career. I'm going to start off doing some shows in New York City.
Okay.
And then I'm just going to hopefully go from there, you know, with build relationships, you know, with some agents and different people, and working with you as well, you know, to just try to give the people what they want, like give people live music.
Nice, nice. So are there any cities that you haven't been to yet across the country, as far as the continental U.S., that you would like to, or you have plans to hit that you haven't hit before?
Well, I've never been to Texas.
Okay. That's a big market, man. Houston?
That's a big market, you know. I like to go to Texas. I did a show once in Chicago. I just think that where primarily there's a heavy concentration of people that are interested in soul and R&B, you know, that's where I want to go. Obviously, I would love to come to Atlanta.
Oh, definitely. We'd love to have you too, bro.
Some shows down there, because I know you were telling me that there's a lot of venues there, venues, but people still, you know, support going out, you know, on the weekend and seeing live music.
Like, dude,
that's the best experience for me, man. You make the record, you know, you got the record, you got the song, but to be able to deliver that record live,
and oh yeah,
just to perform on stage, interact with the audience, with the crowd, that's, to me, that's the most fulfilling part about being an entertainer and a performer.
Hey, man,
so I'm really looking forward to it.
And let me piggyback on that by saying that Atlanta is one of those towns where it is totally not just the weekend, dude. The weekend is just an extension of the week, but I'm telling you, folks put it down all week long down here. We've got a club called the Apache Cafe, and that's where India Ari started off. And on Wednesdays, they've got this little thing where they, man, you got to check this out, man. You could be up there singing with the band behind you, then all of a sudden the keyboard player gets up and walks away, and another keyboard player jumps in. And then the drummer walks away, and another drummer comes in. And then the singer walks away, another singer comes in. They just interchange all night long. It's incredible, man. But all week long, man, you can go to any club in any part of town Monday through Monday and catch something and be well entertained. You see,
I'm forward to that, LA.
Yeah, I can't wait till my book signing party this weekend over at Club Blitz, because I'm going to have a small version of that myself. And even though it's a big weekend with the One Music Fest over at I think Masquerade, this stuff always going on, like I said. But, you know, you're going to pay now. I mean, you're going to pay 50, 60, 70 bucks to check out all this stuff. Whereas my event, man, it's just $5, man. And you're going to come down. You're going to see reggae artists. You're going to see R&B artists. You're going to see instrumental artists. You're going to see dance artists. You're going to see just all types of different artists. At a bargain basement price, because I believe in getting the music out.
Right. Easily accessible to people.
Easily
that
accessible, that's right.
Yep,
so that's something that's my personal goal, and I always want to try to do something where the artist can still, you know, get a couple bucks, because I'm tired of the free showcase thing and all that stuff, man. I want to see these artists come up. I always want to see the artist get paid. I even, you know, put myself on hold in exchange for getting that artist paid, man, because y'all put in so much work. Y'all are the most little understood, you know, segment of music, and I really want to do everything I can to change that, because y'all, you know, you have to separate yourself just to study your craft and do your thing. You know, people's always trying to take advantage of you anyway. So I try to separate myself from that, man. I've always just secretly said I'm the singer's and musician's best friend.
Still, after all these years, that's it. That's what I'm saying. You've always been that. You've always been that guy from the time we first met. So I feel good about it, man. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk with you and also, you know, to with your listeners.
Well, I appreciate you being here. Like I said, and I knew the time was going to fly by on us, but like I said from the beginning, man, you got to come back and do another show. I don't even want to wait very long. If it's okay with you, I want to go on and schedule you for like another 2 weeks down the line, bro.
I'll be happy to do that, man. I'll be happy to talk with you anytime, LA. You know, it's really my honor.
Thank
you so much.
Thank you, man, because, you know, we have great conversations offline, just me and you on the phone. So, you know, the radio is just another aspect to this thing, and we're just kind of sharing our conversations with the people out there, man. But you've always been an inspiration to me. You're a total signification of the struggle to reach the top. You know, you haven't let anything, and I mean in capital letters, you haven't let anything stop you from achieving your goal. You know you're an artist. You're projecting yourself as such. You know, you keep on putting out music. You keep on writing quality songs. And I think that's what it takes to be a superb artist. And at the end of the day, man, watch and see. When your stuff really, really starts popping, bro, you're going to be really surprised with what you end up with.
To God be the glory for everything.
Everything, brother. And so, yeah, what we're going to do, we're going to, I usually close out the show with Eyes Stuck on Me by Kimosha LaToy. But again, you've got so much music, man. We're just going to have to close out the show with another Tashan song. And this one's called Sexy You. And tell us about that one, because that's got a little bit of rock element to it, right?
Yeah, Sexy You is from the Tommy Rock Project. Yeah, that's kind of produced by Jerome Dickens. That's gonna give you some insight into what the Tommy Rock record's all about. And then the other song is I Can't Stay Away. That's more R&B soul, like a Tashan record. But Sexy You is the Tommy Rock one of the songs on the Tommy Rock album.
Well, check it out. Here's Sexy You. Again, God bless you. One more time, brother. Give them all your contact info, Tashan.
Sure. You can find me on Facebook at Tashan Pierce, TashanPierce, and my website is www.tashan7.com. That's TashanNumber7.com. I would like to invite and encourage, you know, everyone to stop by the website to join. Once you become a member with the email address, you're able to receive a free download from each and every one of the albums that are on there. You know, enjoy the videos that are up there. Check out the media section, you know, the history, and then there's all of the new music. And look forward to seeing me live. I look forward to meeting people and taking the music directly to them. So that's how you can get in touch with me. And again, LA, thank you so much, man, for the time and the energy. That, you know, that you've always given me, always positive, and I really appreciate this opportunity to talk with you and your listeners. Thank you so much.
Well, we're going to count down 14 days, and we're going to have you on back here, man, to finish up, you know, our Wall of Fame show with you. And I like to end all my shows with a little saying, and that is to remember that God has something that he wants us all to do for him, but first, we have to do something good for him. I'm L.A. Jackson with Tashan. And, man, God bless you, bro. Everybody have a great day. Thanks for listening. And Raw Truth Radio all day long. Peace.
Oh, name is Tashan. He said that to all of y'all. Thank you.
Sister.